In this video, I will introduce the type of linear programming problems where the decision variables cannot be any numbers but only integers. This video will be divided into two parts. In the first part, we will focus on integer decision variables. In the second part, we will consider a special type of integer decision variables, binary decision variables, and we will also discuss logical constraints. Let's start with integer decision variables. In this example, the airline company is considering a major purchase of up to 17 new Boeing 757 and 767 jets. The decision must take into account numerous cost and capability factors. For this type of decision problems, we must force the decision variables to take only integer values. Otherwise, the optimal solution will not make sense. Therefore, in some circumstances, we must use integer decision variables for decisions that can only assume integer values. Please pause the video now to see whether you are able to formulate this problem as usual. Define the decision variables, state the objective function, and state the constraints. I have included some hints here. Pause here to finalize your problem formulation. In this example, the company is trying to decide how many 757 and how many 767 they should purchase, so two decision variables. I use B5 to represent the number of Boeing 757 purchased and B6 to represent the number of 767 purchased. The objective of this decision problem is to maximize the annual passenger carrying capacity, given that each 757 carries 125,000 passengers and each 767 plane carries 81,000 passengers. We can calculate the total annual passenger carrying capacity using B5 and B6 defined above. We use max here to maximize it in LINGO. There are four constraints for this problem. The airline can only purchase up to 17 new jets in total. That means B5 plus B6 cannot be more than 17. The planes are very costly. The airline can finance up to $400 million in purchases. Each 757 jets costs $35 million, while each 767 jets costs $22 million. So the total cost, that is 35 multiplied by B5 and 22 multiplied by B6, cannot be more than $400 million. Instead of carrying many zeros in this line, I convert everything into millions of dollars. You are welcome to do that, but just be sure that the left-hand side of an equation has the same unit as that of the right-hand side of the equation. We also need at least 1/3 of the planes purchased should be the longer range 757. That means if the total number of planes purchased is 9, B5 should be at least more than 1/3 multiplied by 9, that is 3. So we can write B5 is more than 1/3 multiplied by the sum of B5 and B6. The last constraint requires that the annual maintenance budget is to be no more than $8 million. We first calculate the annual maintenance for both types of planes, sum them up, and make sure it is less than 8. After entering our model to LINGO, here is the printout we received. The optimal solution is to purchase 4.44 757 jets and 8.88 767 jets. I'm sure you will not submit this solution to your supervisor. The solution makes no sense at all. What is the point of buying a fraction of an airplane? Can we round the numbers to the nearest integers instead? When we do that, we should purchase 4 757 jets and 9 767 jets. But 4 and 9 are infeasible solution because we will not be able to meet the last constraint that says at least 1/3 of the planes should be 757 jets. So instead of defining B5 and B6 as real number decision variables, we should false lingo only consider integer valued solutions. It is actually very simple to do that. In lingo, all we need to do is to use the keyword gin to define these integer valued decision variables. GIN stands for general integers. Make sure that you start a GIN keyword using at sign. And you have to define one variable at a time and treat these lines as additional constraints. After declaring B5 and B6 as integers, here is the optimal solution we obtained. We should purchase 5 757 jets and 8 767 jets, resulting in a maximum of 1,273,000 passenger carrying capacity every year. This time, all constraints are satisfied. You may also notice that this time, the model class is no longer LP. Instead, it is a PILP, which stands for Pure Integer Linear Programming. As we have declared all of the decision variables B5 and B6 being binary. Here is the comparison of the optimal solution when at GIN is used versus when it is not used. As you can see, declaring some decision variables as integers is critical for the success of decision making. In the second part of this video, I will discuss a special kind of integer decision variables that only takes two values, 0 or 1. They are called binary decision variables. This type of variables are particularly useful when we make yes or no decisions. We will also discuss a set of constraints that are frequently associated with binary decision variables that are called logical constraints. Let's begin. The example we will consider here is a capital budgeting example. This company is considering 4 projects that have different capital requirements over the next 4 years. Because the company has limited capital each year, as you can see in the table, the management would like to choose the most profitable projects that they can afford to maximize the total present value. The estimated present value of each project, the capital requirements, and the available capital funds are all given in this table. Please pause the video here to see whether you are able to identify the decision variables, the objective function, and the constraints. I underline some of the information on this slide. This is a rather standard linear programming problem that you have seen earlier in this class. The only tricky part is the decision variables. The company has to consider which projects to invest in, meaning they would make 4 yes or no decisions. Should they invest in plant expansion? Should they invest in warehouse expansion, new machinery, or new product research? We denote these decisions using 4 binary decision variables, x1, x2, x3, and x4. x1 is only 1 when we decide to invest in plant expansion project, and 0 otherwise. With all the decision variables defined, we can state the objective function. The company tries to maximize the total present value. We know that the plant expansion has a present value of $90,000. If we do decide to invest in this project, that means the total present value would increase by $90,000. On the other hand side, if we decide not to invest in plant expansion, the total present value would not increase at all. This can also be achieved by multiplying 90,000 with x1, where x1 is either 1 when we decide to invest in this project or 0 when we decide not to invest in this project. Taking the last project, new product research, as another example. If x4 is 1, meaning that we accept this project, then the total present value should go up by $37,000. If x4 is 0, meaning that we reject this project, the total present value should go up by 0. We sum up all of these present values for these 4 projects together and use this as our objective function. Our goal here is to maximize this objective function. The constraints in this problem are all capital requirement constraints. For example, in year 1, the available capital is $40,000. In this year, if the company invests in all 4 projects, the total capital requirement in year 1 will be 15 plus 10 plus 10 plus 15, that is $50,000. This is actually higher than the available capital of $40,000. So it is not possible for the company to invest in all 4 projects. By using the same idea we used for the objective function, we have the capital constraint for year 1 to be 15 multiplied by x1 plus 10 multiplied by x2 plus 10 multiplied by x3 plus 15 plus x multiplied by x4 less than or equal to 40, which is the capital constraint. Please pause the video here to see whether you are able to write the remaining 3 constraints for year 2, year 3, and year 4 respectively. We have learned to use binary decision variables to model yes or no decisions. They can also be used to formulate logical constraints, including mutual exclusion, conditional, co-requisite, k out of n logical constraints. Let's look at a few examples here. A mutually exclusive constraint is about choosing between 2 alternatives. It permits one of the 2 alternatives to be chosen, but not both. For example, the capital budgeting example we were working on has an additional constraint. Due to limited budget, either new machinery project X3 or new product research project X4 can be implemented, but not both. When we try to decide between new machinery versus new project research, we have a total of 4 cases here. 1, 2, 3, 4. I've listed all 4 cases here. The first case is we have both new machinery and a new product research project. So I put 1 for X3 and 1 for X4. The second case is we only have new machinery project. X1 for X3 and 0 for X4. By going through every single one of them, we can see that here, cases 2, 3, and 4 are feasible choices under the mutual exclusive constraint. But how do we represent these 3 cases using a mathematical expression? By manipulating the 2 variables x3 and x4, eventually we should be able to see that x3 plus x4 less than or equal to 1 is the constraint that would do the job. For example, 1 plus 0 is 1, that is less than or equal to 1. 0 plus 1 is also 1, that is less than or equal to 1. And the last case, 0 plus 0 is 0, that is certainly less than 1. A conditional constraint is whenever A is implemented, B is also implemented. In our example, this constraint could be if the plant is expanded, then the warehouse must also be expanded. Again, we present all 4 cases in a table format. Going through all cases, we can see that the only cases that's not feasible is case number 2. As case number 2 says, if A is implemented, B is not implemented. This is exactly the opposite of what we wanted. All other 3 cases are feasible cases. We can use x1 less than or equal to x2 to represent this relationship. For example, for case number 1, x1 is 1, that is equal to x2, which is also 1. For case number 3, x1 is 0, which is less than 1 for x2. Co-requisite constraint requires that if A is implemented, then B must also be implemented and vice versa. Back to our capital budgeting example. For example, if the plant is expanded x1, then new machinery project x3 must be carried out and vice versa. For all 4 cases, only the first case and the last case meet the constraint. This constraint can be represented using x1 equals to x3. The last logical constraint is called k out of n constraints. A generic statement is at most or at least k out of n alternatives can be implemented. For example, the company requires at most 3 projects to be carried out next year. So a constraint, x1 plus x2 plus x3 plus x4 less than or equal to 3 is required for this condition. If the requirement is at least 3 projects to be implemented, then the sign of the constraint is changed to greater than or equal to. Here is the final linear programming model that contains both the capital requirements constraint and also the logical constraints. Because all of the x's are binary decision variables, not just any integer valued variables, we would have to specify them using at bin function in Lingo. Be sure to end each line with semicolons as well. Here is the optimal solution generated from Lingo. The optimal solution is to accept the planned expansion, the warehouse expansion, the new machinery project, but reject the new product research project for a total of a present value of $140,000. I hope you found this example useful. This also concludes this video.